in the content of EHV2. So this last lecture, 27, we have devoted to sum up what we have been discussing, you know, throughout this course and also in EHV1. In this session, we will try to sum up that whatever we see as a proposal for the reality of existence as a whole, of human existence and participation of human being in this existence. How do we go about seeing this reality through my own experience? So not only in terms of understanding it through my thought, through my rationality, but also going deeper into the higher activity of the self and see them, these realities, directly with direct observation. And that's what we are calling it, experientially. Okay. And therefore, understand them and ensure that all our feeling, all our thought, all our activities of the self are in line with this reality, this existence as coexistence. And therefore, all our expression outside are also guided by this. So what do we do about it? So all that we have tried to talk about in practice session till now, under exercise 1 and exercise 2, was essentially an effort for this. So we will try to sum up, sum up what we have been, trying to do to ensure the understanding of reality by direct observation and to live with this reality, with this coexistence, with this harmony, with this relationship in our expression, in terms of behavior, in terms of work, in terms of participation in the larger order. So let us look at that. So we have been talking about role of human being in this existence, and we saw that the role of human being in this existence is to understand the coexistence and to live in coexistence. So we say very briefly, this is the role of human being. But if you want to make it more expressive, then we can say coexistence, harmony and relationship in place of coexistence, because we have seen through our discussion, through our exploration, that this coexistence is in the coexistence in existence is expressing itself in terms of harmony in nature and in terms of relationship between units in nature. So whether we talk in terms of coexistence or we talk in terms of coexistence with expression as harmony and relationship, it is same thing, but it is more expressive. So now we are saying that the role of human being in this existence is to understand the coexistence, harmony and relationship, and to live in coexistence, harmony and relationship. Right. This is the role of human being in this existence. And this we have expressed diagrammatically in this form. And I am sure by now you must have having this at the back of your mind. So this is the expression of this understanding of coexistence, harmony and relationship. Of course, starting with the realization of coexistence and expressing it in terms of our first, in terms of our feeling and thought at the level of imagination, and ultimately expressing it in terms of our behavior, work and participation in the larger order, leading to ultimately human tradition. So this human conduct in its completeness would look like this. So this is where we want to reach each one of us as a human being. So this is the role. Now we can see as to what is the human conduct in its completeness, right? However, we do not seem to be ready for it. So we can see, we can feel, at least we can have the clarity at the level of thought, at the level of imagination, that this is our role in this existence as a human being, to understand the coexistence, harmony and relationship, and to live in coexistence, harmony and relationship. So at the level of thought, at the level of imagination, at the level of feel, we have this acceptance for this. But when we look at ourselves and evaluate our own status or state of being, then we find that we are not prepared for it, we are not ready for it, because we do not have the realization of coexistence, or we may not have the understanding of harmony or contemplation of relationship. So at the level of thought, there is an acceptance. At the level of imagination, at the level of feel, there is an acceptance. But if we are not prepared for it, what do we do? How do we go about it? So this is the question. How do we go about ensuring this, you know, moving up to the higher activities of the self, right? And trying to see this relationship, harmony and coexistence, and also make sure that all our feeling thoughts are in line with this relationship, harmony and coexistence, and our behavior, that is external expression in terms of behavior, etc., is also in line with relationship, harmony and coexistence. So this is what we have been trying to work on this course, on work on in this course UHB2. That is, we are trying to understand what to do through lectures 1 to 28. And we are trying to practice how to do through practice session 1 to 14. So what we have been doing in practice exercise 1 and exercise 2 is essentially trying to work on moving towards the higher activities of the self, towards contemplation of relationship, understanding of harmony, realization of coexistence, and from there making sure that all our feeling and thoughts are in line with relationship, harmony and coexistence. So what we have to do, we have been able to see, at least at the level of thought, the level of clarity in thought through lectures 1 to 28, and we have been working on how to ensure this understanding myself and ensuring these feelings and thought in myself through the practice session 1 to 14 in exercise 1 and exercise 2. So this is the upward movement towards the higher activity of the self. So we are saying conduct when ascending from lower activities to the higher activities, or ascending to the higher activities. So the very basic thing, if you look at this imagination part, this yellow block B2, right, that block of thought, we have mentioned certain things on the right side. It says at the level of selecting and testing, we are developing the test for coexistence, harmony and relationship over and above sensation. So this is interesting. So all our achievement of the content which we discussed in UHB1 and now in UHB2 through lecture 1 to 28, right? The minimum achievement of this is that we are able to see that there are sensations in the body, there are some feelings coming from other people, but, you know, and that we have to test, but we have to develop the test for this coexistence, this harmony, this relationship. So it is something of meaning, something of interest for us, and therefore we must pay attention to it. If this much is there, we are beginning to work on our activities of the self, right? And, you know, preparing ground for moving up. So if that ground is there and we have started appreciating the need, the utility, the usefulness of coexistence, harmony and relationship, that is, we have developed a test for it, then we will pay attention. We'll try to see what these things are, try to understand, at least at the level of thought, at the level of analyzing and comparing. And if we see this and work on this level of thought, at the level of analyzing and comparing, then we begin to see that this coexistence, this harmony, this relationship is important. And therefore, they start becoming the basis of my analysis, basis of my thought. This is another important shift that will take place in us. And if this shift takes place, then we develop a desire for understanding this coexistence, harmony and relationship. So this desire for understanding coexistence, harmony and relationship is a major, you know, achievement of all my effort to understand the reality, the human being, the participation of human being in this nature, in this existence. So if you look at the whole level of imagination as a whole, the achievement of all our, you know, self-study, self-exploration, investigation is essentially to see the importance of coexistence, harmony and relationship, and developing this desire, this willingness to work for understanding this coexistence, harmony and relationship. This desire is what prepares the ground for us to move up to the block of realization, to the block of right understanding. So that shift from B2 to B1 is through this feel, that need, that I have to understand this coexistence, harmony and relationship. I have to live with this coexistence, harmony and relationship because it is important for me. And therefore I have to understand it. So that's a very important shift. With that, we start paying attention within ourselves. With that, we start paying attention to the higher activities of the self and try to look for this contemplation, this understanding, this realization of relationship, harmony and coexistence. So that need is being generated at the level of imagination, to live with coexistence, harmony and relationship, and therefore to understand coexistence, harmony and relationship. So this is a major step. So once we have that need and we are willing to understand, then we start paying attention to our higher activities of contemplation, understanding and realization. Once we move up to this block B1, it starts making lot of difference, because till now we were dealing with the words, with the ideas, with the thought, right? But now we are willing to see the reality directly by direct observation. And to begin with, we said that one of the way to access this B1, this higher activity of the self, is just by asking our own natural acceptance. Natural acceptance, which is already there, which is always there in us. And this comes from the block B1. So to get idea about this higher activity of the self, the simplest way is to access our own natural acceptance. The natural acceptance, which is always the innate, the intact, the invariant, uncorrupted by our preconditioning and sensation. So that definiteness of block one, B1, can be seen by observing our own natural acceptance. So that is what we will use as the source for looking into any reality, looking into any relationship, right? And trying to observe this reality, this relationship directly by direct observation at the level of B1, at the level of higher activities of the self. So this is what we are doing. In fact, if you look at these exercises that we are doing now, if you look at these exercises 1 and 2, we'll be able to understand what we are doing, right? And that we will see, try to look at this device. But the basic idea is this, that we want to, you know, see the importance of this coexistence, harmony and relationship over and above the sensation, the physical facility, the body. And once we see the importance, we are trying to understand this relationship, harmony and coexistence by direct observation, by way of awakening to the higher activities of the self. And this beginning is done by referring to our own natural acceptance, which is there, which is in it. Right. So how to proceed for contemplation, understanding and realization? The role of human being in this existence is to understand the coexistence, harmony and relationship, and to live in coexistence, harmony and relationship that we have mentioned. And this is what we are trying to understand, at least, you know, through at the level of thought, right? Through lecture 1 and 28. Now, how do we see it experientially? How do we see it by direct observation? This is what we are trying to do through practice session 1 to 14, through exercise 1 and 2, and later on through exercise 3. So if you remember, in UHB 1 itself, we said that first we have to understand the reality, the existence, and at least we have to have it at the level of, you know, clarity, at the level of thought. With this, we have to ensure the feeling and thought of coexistence, and accordingly line up our behavior, work and participation in the larger order on the basis of understanding of coexistence, harmony and relationship. So this is one part, the self-exploration, the self-study that we have been calling. So this self-study is important, and what is the outcome of it is what we have just discussed right now. Then we are saying that this clarity at the level of thought is not enough. We have to do something more, and that something more is that we have to be self-aware. So we have to work for self-awareness, and then we have to work for self-evaluation. So these are two steps which are important. that there is a need for self-exploration, self-study to understand the reality outside and reality within, right? And our sharing with the world outside. But this is likely to help us to have that clarity at the level of thought. This can be reinforced and we can move to the level of understanding through these two things more, you know, and that is self-awareness and self-evaluation. So this self-awareness and self-evaluation is what we are doing through exercise one, and then mainly through exercise one, and then also some part, you know, through exercise two. But exercise two is focusing not only looking at the self and trying to understand it, but also looking at the interaction of the self with the world outside. But exercise one is focusing mainly on looking at the self. So the self-awareness is what we are working on, and then self-evaluation is what we are working on, evaluating our desire, thought and expectation on the basis of our natural acceptance, on the basis of relationship, harmony and coexistence every moment. So this is what we have been trying to do through. And when we are saying this sanskar, which is word which we'll keep using, sanskar is the acceptances which is derived out of our desire, thought and expectation that we have accumulated over all our, you know, past. And this sanskar can be updated through environment and self-exploration that we have been talking about. So that is what we are trying to do. We are trying to update our sanskars through the process of self-exploration. Then we are saying, we are doing these exercises with the purpose of self-evolution. So we want to evolve ourselves by way of awakening to contemplation, understanding and realization. And also by way of purification of our sanskar. So we have accumulated a lot of acceptances out of our accumulated desire, thought and expectation, out of our accumulated imaginations. And these have to be looked into, evaluated, and purified. So essentially, we are doing two things. We are, number one, trying to awaken ourselves to the higher activities of the self, as I mentioned, to the activity of contemplation, understanding, and realization. And second, I am being aware of my sanskar, I am being aware of my desire, thought and expectation every moment. I am trying to purify them. So I am being aware of them, I am evaluating them, and then I am making sure that whatever is the right sanskar, right feeling, that I will continue with. And whatever is not right, right, at least I do not have the willingness to continue with it. I may not try to remove it by force, but I can see that it is not important for me. And if I can see that it's not important for me, it will naturally drop down. I do not have to force it. I do not have to kind of react to it. Right? I can just observe and evaluate, and that's enough. So this is what we are trying to do. So let us now see how we can work for self-development through this exercise one and exercise two. So I will try to place the discussions that we had when we were talking about exercise one and exercise two. Though all of you are, you know, aware of this exercise one and exercise two, because we spent almost, you know, 15 days working on the different, you know, steps of exercise one and exercise two. But I want to place some of the important proposals or important points that we had talked about, these exercise one and exercise two, particularly to bring to your attention that these exercise one and two is essentially for ensuring the self-development, right, in terms of awakening to this contemplation, understanding and realization, and for the purification of our sanskar, which essentially means, you know, for ensuring the self-evolution, self-development. So let's look at them. As we mentioned, exercise one and two, we each one of us are doing these exercises for developing ourselves, developing understanding and purification of accumulated feelings and thoughts. We said the purpose of this exercise one and two is ultimately continuous happiness, continuous fulfillment. And we said that anything that we do is ultimately for this purpose of ensuring continuous fulfillment, continuous happiness. The important thing that we have been able to observe and conclude through UHB1 and now reinforced through UHB2 is that to ensure continuity of happiness, we need to develop three things: right understanding in the self, right feeling and right thought in the self, and competence for right living with the world outside. So this is interesting. This we have been discussing right from the first session in ESV1, where we said that for ensuring continuity of happiness and prosperity, we need to have right understanding, we have to have right feeling in relationship, and we have to have the fulfillment with the world outside, in terms of relationship with human being, in terms of relationship with nature, and so on. So these three things are required. And therefore, we are doing these exercises in order to develop these three things: right understanding in the self of the existential reality. This existential reality can be viewed as self, body, family, society, nature, and the entire existence. Or it can be viewed as material and consciousness units submerged in space. So the right understanding of this reality, the existential reality in the self, is one important thing. The second thing, important thing, is right feeling and right thought of relationship, harmony and coexistence in the self. And third is competence for right living. And this competence has to be there in the self first. Once we have this competence in the self, then we can express it outside the outside world through our body. So we have to have the competence for right living in the self, that is living in relationship, harmony and coexistence with the world outside. And then I can express it in terms of my behavior, work and participation in the larger order. So this is what I have to do in order to ensure continuity of happiness. Now we see that our focus in these exercises is going to be, particularly the exercise one is going to be the self, right? So we'll work on the self first. And once we are able to see the self right, set the self right, we will be able to live in harmony within, and also will be ready to live in harmony with the world outside. Therefore, our major focus would be on ensuring right understanding of existential reality, and right feeling and right thought, both in the self. So right understanding of existential reality in the self, and right feeling and right thought in the self. And if you look at this right understanding of the existential reality, one of the ways is to see the material and the consciousness units submerged in space. And when you look at this right feeling and right thought, it can be seen in terms of the feeling of relationship, harmony and coexistence. So this is what we have to do in essence, right? So we have to understand the material unit, the consciousness unit, and their submergence in space, their coexistence in space. And second, when it comes to my feeling and thought, I have to ensure that I have the feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence. And my thoughts are guided by it, my expectations are guided by it. So this is what I have to do at the level of self. Once this is there at the level of self, I can very naturally express it outside as and when necessary. That will be a natural expression, natural extension. Then we noticed that to live with fulfillment, we need to understand. To understand, we need to see, to observe. And to see, we need to pay attention, to be mindful. So if I want to live with something with mutual fulfillment, first I have to understand that thing. This we will see amply in its exercise 1, step 5. That with right understanding of the reality, we can live with that reality in a mutually fulfilling manner, not otherwise. So we need to understand. But when we want to understand, we have to see things, see the reality, observe the reality. And when we have to observe the reality, see the reality, we have to pay attention. We have to be mindful of it. So in these exercises, we are paying attention to see, to understand, and ultimately to live with fulfillment. So the goal is to live with fulfillment. For that, we are trying to understand. For that, we are trying to pay attention. There are two important aspects while paying attention. Number one, to identify what is the object of attention. And second, what is the process of paying attention? So that is what we looked at, right? And now if you see this, the object of attention is whatever is to be understood, whatever is to be lived with. So whatever I am living with, I need to understand. And whatever I want to understand, I have to pay attention. So that is the object of attention. And what is the process of paying attention? By being aware, to evaluate without reaction. This is the process. So if I expand on this, what is to be known is ultimately the whole existence. Right? Which means understanding these units, the material and consciousness unit submerged in space. So we'll try to understand the consciousness, the self first, then the material, and then the coexistence, the space. So by way of the following exercise, we are doing it. Exercise 1 is to understand the consciousness in detail. Exercise 2 is to understand the material, the body, for example, in detail. And exercise 3 is for understanding the coexistence, understanding the space. But we are not going to talk about that, you know, in this course, because that calls for set of preparation, which we'll be able to do in exercise 1 and exercise 2. So we'll prepare the ground for exercise 3, but not work on exercise 3 in detail. So existence is in the form of coexistence. So we have unit and space, we have material unit and the consciousness unit. So we have to study, we have to understand, we have to pay attention. So if you look at the sequence, we have said that we first start with the self, because to the self is understanding things, which is seeing things. So first self has to be understood and set right. Then we can look at the body, and then we can look at this coexistence, the space. So self is this here, the body is used as an instrument. So we will start with the self and set it right first. So the sequence of this exercise will be, number one, seeing the self by the self, that is consciousness, observing and understanding the consciousness. Then seeing the body by the self, so the consciousness, observing the material, the body. And third, seeing the coexistence by the self, so the consciousness, observing the coexistence. And this coexistence, to begin with, can be seen as distance between the self and the body. And then as relationship between the self and the body. So this is something which we can immediately begin with. But as we go on, we'll be able to see that not only the self is submerged in space, but every unit is submerged in space. And you can see that the self, while remaining submerged in space, is able to share with the world outside through space, particularly the body through space, that we will see. So the basic idea is that till now we have been looking outside and not paying attention to the inside. Now we have to pay attention to the inside as well. Right? And then the sequence would be that first we pay attention to the inside, understand the self. And then with that understanding in the self, of the self, we can now look at the world outside, right? Understand that world, recognize our relationship with that reality, and be ready to fulfill that reality. At least at the level of imagination, we have the preparation to live with the other reality in a mutually fulfilling manner, through relationship, harmony, and coexistence. So that readiness comes out of my ensuring harmony in the self first. So we have to look inward, work on self, develop the self, and with that developed self, now look outside, understand the world outside, recognize your relationship, and fulfill that relationship. That is how the sequence would be, what we have written here. So with this, we can work with exercise one, right? That is observing the self by the self. So this, a few things which we have noticed. We said because we are going to observe the self by the self, and this observation can be done directly by the self without taking help of the body. So I can look at the self by looking at the imagination that is going on in the self, looking at the desire, thought, and expectation that are going on in the self. Right. This I can see by the self directly. I don't need to use my eyes. I don't need to use my body. Right. I can observe my imagination, my desire, my thought, my expectation directly. Therefore, I don't need to take help of the body in the process. And therefore, we can give rest to the body. Keep the body in a comfortable position. Keep your eyes in a comfortable position. Because we are not going to make use of the body to see the self by the self. The self can see the self directly. I can directly see myself. I can see my imagination, my desire, my thought. Only thing that I have to do is to decide to pay attention. So that competence is there to see, that potential is there to see, but we have not used this potential because we did not pay attention to ourselves. Now we have started paying attention to ourselves. Right? Now we can decide that we have to pay attention and see ourselves. So when I do it, when I look at my imagination directly, I can see my imagination directly, right? And I don't need to involve my body for this purpose. So this is one important thing, giving rest to the body, to the eyes, so on, and directly observing the self by the self. When we do this, you know, we have been doing it in 7 steps. Of course, we said that these are the possible, you know, one of the possible steps. In fact, the exercise one itself is one of the possible way of looking at the self, looking at the reality, looking at the connect. That is of importance. But this exercise is one of the way of going about investigating into oneself, to existence, and so on. It is not the only way. And similarly, the 7 steps that we are talking about here is also one set of steps which we thought will be suitable for our state of being, of my own state and the state of people with whom I am sharing. So these 7 steps are not sacrosanct steps. They are designed or developed with this view of our own condition, right? My own condition, our condition, and condition with whom we are trying to share. But it is useful step that we can see. But this is not the only steps. You can have another set of steps, you know. Even these steps can be, you know, made more subtle or more gross depending upon, you know, what is your state of observation, how awakened you are to the higher activities of the self. Depending upon that, the seven steps can be either expanded further or it can be made brief. But anyway, we will start working with the seven steps. And if we develop the competence, we may think in terms of making it more concise. So these seven steps that we have been talking about, I'm not going to read them out in detail because we have been working on it, almost spending one full day at every step. But let me see what, talk about what we have been trying to do and what we have been able to see, what has been our achievement, but then that we can keep in focus and, you know, work these exercises properly. So some important observations about exercise one. The details of the seven steps is given in slide later, which we are not going to discuss now. It has already been discussed, but they are available for reference. However, some of the important points to keep in mind are, now I have tried to bring out those steps and an important point in each step. So in step one, we are being aware of our imagination, of our desire, the feeling, the thought, the expectation. And we are being aware every moment without any reaction. So no reaction with equanimity. This is very important. So step one, two things are very important. Number one, I am being aware of my imagination, particularly my desire, my feeling. And number two, this observation, this awareness is every moment in continuity. And number two, while I'm observing, there is no reaction. I don't react. I just observe. Right? I just be aware, and that is it. Step one is just being aware. But this awareness has to be there every moment. That is what we have to work. And while we are working on it, no reaction. If there is a feeling which is not desirable for you, don't react. Don't try to remove it. Right? Just observe that there is a feeling which is not naturally acceptable to me. Later on, we'll see. First, I'm aware of the feeling that I have at this moment. Then I'm able to evaluate whether it is natural or unnatural. Then I have to evaluate whether it is going to lead to happiness or unhappiness. So that we will do in step two and three, this evaluation part. Step one, we are not making evaluation. We are just being aware of the desire or needs. And we are observing it without any reaction. Without reacting, without trying to stop them, without trying to change them. Just the observation, and that's it. This is very simple but very important step that we have been mentioning in quite detail. So I'm not going into that. Now in step two and three, we are being aware and evaluating your desire, our desire, the feelings. So observe, you know, your feeling and evaluate it. That's what we are doing in step two and three. This helps us to see the feeling that are natural for us and that are leading to happiness. So through step two and three, I can identify which feelings are natural, which are not. And we can also identify that the natural feeling leads to a state of harmony and happiness. An unnatural feeling leads to a state of disharmony and unhappiness. In step four, we are observing who is taking the decision for feeling that I have at this moment? Who is taking the decision for the feeling that you have at this moment? And the conclusion is that I am the one who is taking the decision. I am responsible, therefore. Then step five, we are trying to find out what is the basis of your choice decision. Is it understanding or assumption? So after observation, the conclusion is that understanding leads to definite and natural feeling. It leads to happiness. Right? When I can see this, this highlights the need for understanding. This is important. Right? That if I have the understanding of the reality with which I am interacting, and if I have the understanding about myself, then I can rightly recognize my relationship with the reality and fulfill that relationship. If I don't have the understanding, I am in trouble. So if I can see this, I can see that only through right understanding, I can have the right feeling, the natural feeling for the given reality, and I can fulfill that responsibility. So understanding leads to definite and natural feeling, which leads to happiness. Right? This we are able to observe in step five, and this highlights the need for understanding. So we need to understand the reality we are interacting with. With this, in step 6A, we are trying to find out which feeling is naturally acceptable, feeling of relationship or opposition, and so on. Right? The conclusion is feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence is naturally acceptable and not otherwise. And if I can see this need, then in 6B, we are trying to observe and understand the feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence. So the conclusion of this 6A and 6B is understanding feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence is understanding the whole existence, because that's the how what in the whole existence is. And step 7, once we are able to see that it is the relationship, harmony, and coexistence which is naturally acceptable to us, we are trying to ensure that the desire, the feeling is in line with relationship, harmony, and coexistence at this moment and at every moment. And if I can do this, if I can ensure that all my desire, thought, and expectations are in line with relationship, harmony, and coexistence at this moment and at every moment, then I will be in a state of harmony and happiness at this moment, every moment, and in continuity. So in a sense, what we are doing is, we are seeing through direct observation that feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence is naturally acceptable. This is step 6A. Then understanding the feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence through step 6B, ensuring that our desire, the feeling, our thought is in line with relationship, harmony, and coexistence at this moment, every moment, through step 7. If I do this, this will ensure happiness at this moment, every moment in continuity. However, these two we can do only if we are aware of the imagination every moment. Right? So the important thing is being aware of our imagination every moment. And this is what we are doing through step 1. Right? And it is important to see that it is we who is taking decision for my imagination, for my feeling, and that we are seeing through step 4. So basically through these steps, I am able to see the importance of relationship, harmony, and coexistence at the level of B1. And then we are able to, we can ensure that all our desire, thought, and expectations are in line with this relationship, harmony, and coexistence. And if I can do that, I can be in a state of harmony and happiness in continuity. So this is what is being said. So the most important thing is that we have step one, where we are being aware every moment with no reaction, with equanimity. Then we have step six, observing and verifying the feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence. It's what is naturally acceptable, then trying to understand it. And finally, ensuring that all our feeling, our desire are in line with this. And every moment, you know, at this moment and at every moment, this will ensure harmony, happiness at this moment and every moment, which will ensure continuous happiness in the self, which is our ultimate goal. So this is what we are doing in a sense, and this is what we really need to do. So through exercise one, we are trying to work for seeing ourselves, seeing the existential reality, seeing that relationship, harmony, and coexistence is what is naturally acceptable to us, and then trying to ensure that all our feeling, all our thoughts are in line with this relationship, harmony, and coexistence. And if I can see this and do this, right, I will always be in a state of harmony within, state of happiness within. So that will ensure my continuity of happiness. So this is what we are trying to do through exercise one, and this is what we really need to do. So this is about, you know, exercise one. Similarly, if you look at this exercise two, exercise one, we are setting things right at the level of self, at the level of myself, which is the most important thing. But when we are working for exercise two, we are trying to ensure that with my state of harmony and happiness within in the self, how do I express with the world outside? What is my natural expression with the world outside? So when I'm in a state of harmony and happiness, right, that we have been trying to work for through exercise one. Now when I'm interacting with this world outside, including the body, right, how my interaction is, how my interaction would be. So exercise two is not setting the self right. Self is in a state of harmony and happiness through all these explosions that we talked about. Now with that state of harmony and happiness in the self, now we are trying to see how do we, you know, express it in the world outside. What is going to be our natural expansion with the world outside. That is what we are trying to do in exercise two. So observing and seeing the body and the interaction between the self and the body by the self. So we have seen that this transaction between the self and the body is taking place, and we have to try understanding it, investigate it and understand it. So again, there are seven steps that we have been talking about. So I'll just talk about the essence of the seven steps. So if you look at the seven steps, right, the details has already been given. However, some important points to keep in mind are: step one, we are observing the self, right, through your imagination, and the body through the sensation. The self and body are two distinct realities. So in step one, we are trying to see observe the self by observing the imagination in the self, and we are trying to observe the body by observing the sensation in the body. And when we see this, work on this, important conclusion is that self and body are two distinct realities of different type. Step two and three, we are observing the interaction between the self and the body. And we find that this interaction is in the form of transaction of information only. No material transaction is taking place. And both ways, the decision for transaction is taken by the self and not by the body. Body works as an instrument, right, as per the instruction given by the self. In step four, we are able to look at this, you know, when we are reading the sensation from the body, are we the sensation? Are we in the sensation? Or are we at a distance from the sensation? Can we read the sensation? And do we read the sensation while being at a distance from the sensation? So when we do this observation, the important conclusion is that the self is at a distance from the sensation, while observing the sensation. And if I can see this, I can get a feel of distance between the self and body. Right. So this is something which we have to work on. Step five, we are observing the interaction with the body or the world outside is by way of sensation. It is the self who associates meaning to the sensation, is influenced or remains uninfluenced. It decides for response based on its sanskar. And if sanskar is based on right understanding, it will respond. Otherwise, it will react. So this we can see in step 5 and 6. And ultimately, this is step 7, as we have mentioned, that this is, you know, giving a kind of thought for future work on exercise 3, where we will work and look at this units being submerged in space. But here it can be placed, you know, to begin your exploration and for getting a feel. So step 7, we are saying that let us see that, you know, when I am there, right, I am in space. The body is in space. And the transaction between me and the body is taking place through space. So this is what we are trying to observe. We have gone into details in the while we are talking about this exercise. But here I'm just trying to recall what essentially we have been trying to do and why we are trying to do it and what is going to be the outcome of this. So in a sense, step 1, 2, and 3 helps us to see that the self and body are two distinct realities and there is transaction of information only between the two, right? And this decision of transaction is guided by or taken by the self. So this is what we are able to see through 1, 2, and 3. Through step 4 and 7, right, we can feel that self is at a distance from the sensation. So there is distance between the two. And we can also further see that the self is in space. The body is also in space. And transaction of information between the two is taking place through space. Through step 5 and 6, we can see the interaction of the self with the body or the world outside, right, which is by way of sensation. So it is the self who associates meaning to the sensation, is influenced or remains uninfluenced, decides for response based on its sanskar. And depending upon its sanskar, it is likely to respond or react. So all the 7 points can be reorganized and seen what they are trying to, what we are trying to get through them. And if you further, condense it, it says step 1, 2, 3, 4, and 7, we are able to see that self and body are two distinct reality in space at a distance. There is transaction of information only through space, both where the decision is taken by the self. So this is the essence of these 5 steps. Step 5 and 6, the interaction of the self with the body or the world outside is by way of sensation, is what we are trying to see. It is the self who associates the meaning to the sensation, is influenced or remains uninfluenced, and so on, depending upon its sanskar. Right? So this is important. The sanskar is important. So now we are saying that what we see under A, group A, 1, 2, 3, and 4, and 7, is something that once we see it, it remains with us as understanding. However, what is seen under B is something we can keep observing to get the idea about our sanskar, to evaluate this sanskar and purify it. In fact, we can see that sanskar, while interacting with the body or world outside, in a better way through step 5. So we have to keep working on step 5 to be able to see our sanskar associated with different, you know, sensations coming from the world outside. Right? Very interesting. In fact, it has been experience of many people who have been doing this exercise for last 2 months, is that they are able to see their sanskar much better through this step 5 than through exercise 1. And that we can see, you know, because presently most of your, you know, working in this self is in response to some input from outside. So when there is no input from the outside, you have to really be very, you know, subtle to observe what is going on inside it and what is the sanskar associated with it. But when it is something coming from outside, a sensation, and you are reacting or responding to it, there we can see, you know, what is our sanskar. So that can be a better way to look at our sanskar than directly looking at this self and observing it. At least for many people, this has been the experience. So this is step 5 that we have been talking about, and it's a very versatile step. It covers almost everything. You know, here I have to be aware of this self. So this pink block is all that is happening at the level of self. Then we have to have this brown block where there is mention about what is happening at the level of body. And then at the top is the world outside. So very important step, right? Where we are seeing our own self, our own desire, thought and expectation, our own sanskar. Then we are looking at the body and our interaction with the body, and then we are looking at the world outside. And when we work on this, many, you know, important observations are made and many realities are being understood through this process. So that we have talked about while talking about it. It's step 5. So all these details you can remember, something happening at the level of world outside, this effect is seen at the level of body, and this is read by the self or not read by the self. When it is read by the self, it is interpreted by the self on the basis of that reaction or response. So all that is happening in a very intensive manner, and we can look into them and understand. So this seems to be one of the very versatile and important steps. Step 5 of exercise 2, which we'll keep working on. And this is what is there online, you know, when I'm interacting with the world outside, which we are doing anyway, that I can observe the self, I can observe the body, I can observe the world outside, I can see the interaction between myself and the body, and between the body and the world outside. So this is what we are doing through step 2, right? So step 1, we are being aware of the self and working on the self. With step 2, we are aware of the self as well as the body and the interaction with the body. And through that, we are also aware of the world outside and our interaction with the body and the world outside. The idea of exercise 1 is to ensure the development of the self. And the idea of exercise 2 is to ensure the development of my interaction with the world outside, including the interaction with the body. So improve upon my behavior, my external expression, my behavior, my work, my participation. So this is what we are doing through exercise 1 and exercise 2. And this is what we need to do basically. So if you go through this process, The result of this is self-development that we have talked about in the last session while summing up. So this self-development can be seen in five steps. So I'm not going into the detail. You can recall the discussion last time that we had last session. And if I'm doing this, then what we are ultimately working for, so that we can see. In a sense, what we are doing is, through exercise one, we are working to achieve a state of the self where I am with awareness of all activities of the self, particularly my imagination to begin with. I'm aware every moment with no reaction, with equanimity. I'm observing and verifying that feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence is naturally acceptable to me and not otherwise. I'm observing and understanding the feeling of relationship, harmony, and coexistence through contemplation, understanding, and realization. I'm ensuring that all my desires, feeling, thought, and expectation is in line with relationship, harmony, and coexistence at this moment, every moment. This ensures harmony, happiness at this moment, every moment. And all this put together ensures that I'm in a state of continuous happiness in the self. So this is what I'm doing through exercise one. And then through exercise two, so with the state of the self of harmony and continuous happiness, now through exercise two, we are able to see that the self and the body are two distinct realities in a space at a distance, transacting information through space, right, by the decision of the self. So this is what we are doing through step 1, 2, 3, 4, and 7. Then we have the interaction. We can see that the interaction of the self and body or the world outside is by a way of sensation. The self who associates a meaning to the sensation is influenced or remains uninfluenced, decides for response based on its sanskar. Depending upon its sanskar, it responds or reacts. This is what we are seeing through step 5 and 6. So all this put together, through these observations, we are able to ensure that while I am interacting with the body or the world outside, not only that I remain in a state of harmony and happiness within, but I am able to respond and not react to the world outside, such that it leads to mutual fulfillment. So this is what we are doing in a sense. This is what we really need to do, right? To make sure that we, at the level of self, are in a state of harmony and happiness. And number two, we are able to interact with the body and the world outside in a mutually fulfilling manner. So this is what we are trying to work through exercise one and exercise two. So the question, that we want to relate to the world outside. First, we want to be in harmony with him. And then we want to relate to the whole existence, the whole nature, in a mutually fulfilling manner. Right? So I want to do that. This is what I have to do. I have to work through this exercise one and two. And this will help me to ensure what I want to ensure. That is ensuring continuative happiness in oneself and trying to ensure mutual fulfillment with the world outside. So this is what we intended to share with you in this last session, trying to work out the detail of what to do, what we want to do. So this is going to be our program of action. Right? We'll continue to work with exercise one and exercise two to ensure our self-development, our state of harmony and happiness in the self, and also to ensure mutual fulfillment in our interaction with the world outside, including the body. So with this, I will place this point for self-reflection. So as we were said last time, that now that we have given the proposal to explore the whole existence, the human being and the role of human being in that, the whole existence is now, a reality to be investigated, to be reflected upon. So that was the homework we gave last time. And now with this, identifying as to what we have to do, for ensuring this fulfillment in the self and fulfillment in our relationship with the world. Right? The point for self-reflection is the following. So these 5 points are basically points for self-evaluation. Right? So this is what we have to work on. Right? Trying to evaluate ourselves. Trying to see what has been our achievement through this exercise 1 and 2, right, through this course. And then what are the commitments emerging out of it? So work on this self-evaluation. And of course, after you have worked on it, we would certainly like to listen to your sharing. And that is what we are going to do in days to come. So we would like to listen to your sharing about your self-evaluation. So these points for self-evaluation is list out your understanding emerging out of exercise 1 and exercise 2. Right? What you have been able to understand through the exercise 1 and exercise 2. And of course, you can also include this, include the content of the lecture 1 to 28 you have gone through. So what has been your understanding? What are the reality that you are able to understand? That is 1 point. How many steps are you able to see in yourself clearly? So when you are working with exercise 1 and exercise 2, 7 steps each, how many of these steps you are able to see clearly? Third, happiness is your innate nature and not the effect from outside. How clearly are you able to see this? This is very important, right? Right from the beginning, we made this statement that happiness is something which is innate in us, which is a natural characteristic of self and not an effect from outside. So now we have gone through the whole process of exploration. Now we are asking, how do you see now things? Now this happiness is your innate nature. Or it is still effect from outside. So how clearly are you able to see this? Number 4, if you can see that happiness is your innate nature, is your natural characteristic, then what is your program to ensure it? So all that we have been talking about, exercise 1 and 2, is essentially trying to work out the program for ensuring this continuity of happiness in the self, which is our innate nature. So what do you see, as program to ensure it? And in contrast to that, or in compared to that, you can also look into these 2 points. How much of this program is for trying to get favorable effect, right, through sensation or feeling from outside, even now? Because if I can see that it is my innate nature, it is my natural characteristic, it is my innateness, then I will work within, to get continued happiness. If I'm not able to see that, I am still looking at some way to get a favorable effect from outside. Second question is, how much of this program is keeping in focus the self, and how much of this program is keeping in focus the body? If it is focusing on the body, we are still waiting for some effect, favorable effect to make ourselves happy. And the 5th point is, with all this understanding, clarity, and all that, what you can see as your commitment. And specifically, how much time you can develop for developing right understanding, right feeling in yourself. And how much time that is self-development, right? How much time you can spend for self-development. And second, how much time can you devote for your social responsibility, for your natural extension with the world outside. So for social responsibility, emerging out of your natural self-expression, along with your present commitment. So you already have some commitment, but with that commitment and with your status of the self, how much time and of course effort you can devote for social responsibility. And this is social responsibility is emerging out of your natural self-expression, self-extension. Not by force. And just a suggestion that at least we can devote 2 hours for each of these. But that you have to find out for yourself. So these are the points for self-reflection. These are the points for self-evaluation. And with this, I will call it a day for, and also I will complete this course, you know, on EHB2. And listen to your sharings, your self-evaluation from tomorrow onwards. So with this, I will close with my feeling. And my feeling is that this effort of sharing these proposals and also, you know, working through these exercises has been very meaningful, very fulfilling for me. And I hope that it has been meaningful and fulfilling for you as well. But from my side, I can say that it has been fulfilling for me. What has been the outcome of it for you is what we would like to listen to you from tomorrow morning. So with this, thank you very much. Unless there is a very urgent question, we'll call it a day. But if there is something very urgent, we'll take it up.